Welcome to the latest in a series of State Senator Bill Dodd's virtual town halls. Tonight's event is presented in partnership with KSVY 91.3 FM in Sonoma and Sonoma TV. And the topic is California housing crisis and what the state is doing to address it. I'm Rick Wynn, one of the volunteer hosts on KSVY 91.3 in Sonoma. This evening's town hall has been being presented on multiple video platforms, including Senator Dodd's Facebook page, facebook.com/sendbilldodd, sd03.senate.gov.ca, Sonoma TV Comcast Channel 27 in the Sonoma Valley, sonomatv.org, and the Sonoma TV channel on YouTube. For audio only, tune in to KSVY 91.3 FM in Sonoma County or stream on ksvy.org or your home smart device. Tonight's event features two distinguished panelists talking about California's housing crisis and what the state is doing to address it. Senator Dodd and the panelists will take your questions beginning at about 6:30. The studio call-in number is 707-933-9133. That's at 6:30. Call in at 707-933-9133. We also have a large number of questions previously submitted by email, and we will make every attempt to get those in, the ones that are not addressed by the panelists in their opening remarks and subsequent discussion. Senator Dodd represents all or part of six North Bay counties, including Napa, Sonoma, Solano, Contra Costa, Sacramento, and Yolo counties. And now I turn it over to Senator Dodd, who will make his opening remarks and introduce this evening's panel. Good evening, Senator.
Good evening. Thanks to our panelists and KSVY for convening our first virtual town hall of 2022. But it's our 17th since the beginning of the pandemic. And Rick, I really want to give a shout out to you for doing this for us every step of the way. Thanks so much. Tonight, we'll be talking about our state's housing crisis and what we are doing to increase the construction of new and more affordable homes. I'm very glad to be joined by this distinguished group. And thanks to the hundreds of people tuning in tonight, the fact that you are here shows your concern. We will take your email questions and open the phone lines, as Rick said, at 6:30. Once again, the call-in number is 707-933-9133. It's no secret California is a major housing problem. We haven't been building enough to meet demand. That undersupply has driven housing prices through the proverbial roof for buyers as well as renters. The median home price is set to jump north of $800,000 this year. That's about twice the national average and the second highest in the country behind only Hawaii. California's high housing costs have resulted in our state having the nation's highest rate of functional poverty. Also, it has put us near the bottom in home ownership. A December report from the Public Policy Institute of California said home production has actually slowed in California since the early 2000s. We went from building 147,000 homes in the first decade per year in the first decade of the century to only 71,000 last year. This happened as the state added 3.2 more people than housing units over the past 10 years. The trend of building fewer homes has been going on for years. Now estimates are that we need millions of new homes to be built to make up for it. Legislative leaders, in partnership with Governor Newsom and statewide officials, are determined to make this happen. This past year, we passed new laws to increase our housing supply. Senate Bill 9, for example, facilitates the building of duplexes to get people of all income levels into housing. And SB 10 streamlines the process for local approval of multi-unit housing in urban areas and near transit. And our balanced budget included a $1.7 billion investment to accelerate the production of 84,000 new affordable housing units. The budget also contains bold new provisions to address homelessness. So while the housing affordability crisis undermines the California dream for many families, we are taking steps to solve this most vexing issue. but there's still a lot more work to be done. And here tonight are two people on the front lines of this issue. My good friend Fiona Ma has been California's treasurer since 2019. She was previously a member of the State Board of Equalization. She served as Speaker Pro Tem of the Assembly and was a San Francisco supervisor. As treasurer, she plays the role in construction financing and has advocated for housing tax credits and revenue bonds to build affordable housing, as well as units for unsheltered and college students. Also with us tonight is Gustavo Velasquez, Director of the Department of Housing and Community Development. HCD provides housing loans and grants to tens of thousands of families each year. It also provides rental assistance and has been a key player in affordable home construction. I want to welcome you both here. Thank you for taking time out of your busy schedules. Now let's hear from Treasurer Ma.
Thank you, Senator Dodd. And as you will see shortly, Gustavo and I are very passionate about housing and making a dent in the housing crisis. For the last 2 years, I have chaired every meeting, TCAC and SIDLAC, in person, even during the pandemic, to make sure that we keep our calendar on schedule. We have made numerous regulation changes, disaster credits, thanks to Mike Thompson, in the first year that we had to roll out, or otherwise we would have lost them. And so there has been a lot of moving parts. And I will just start out by saying the 2008 Great Recession obviously impacted the housing crisis, as did the demise of the redevelopment agencies. I was in the legislature when that vote was put before us, and we really didn't think that the governor at the time, Governor Jerry Brown, was really going to get rid of redevelopment. He was using it, we thought, as a negotiating tool. And then at the last minute, it was like, he's gonna abolish it. And San Francisco, which I represent, has four redevelopment agencies. So you can imagine the panic that all these major cities have went into, with all of the experts that they have amassed on their teams that knew how to apply for all the federal and state and local grant programs, all of a sudden were gone. And so that has really slowed us down. But thanks to Governor Gavin Newsom and the excellent team he has put together in housing, this has been a priority for the governor and myself at the treasurer's office. The governor, for the fourth fiscal year in a row, has allocated $500 million in state low-income housing tax credits. This has enabled a lot of the projects that have been sitting on the shelf because they haven't been able to pencil now to dust them off, bring them forward with this extra boost from the governor, and it has made our bonds competitive for the first time in about a couple of decades. And this has created a lot of excitement. I think cities and counties are gonna see more affordable housing projects being built, especially in your district, Senator. We have, number one, the federal disaster credits have really prioritized NAPA, Sonoma counties, because of fires that devastated your region. The extra state low-income housing tax credits has enabled more of these smaller projects to come forward and get approved. And in our financing committees, we have been about 2 to 3 times oversubscribed. So that can tell you how many applicants are out there, and also cities and counties that want to build affordable housing. We hear about those that don't want to, but the majority of cities and counties do want to build affordable housing, and it's a matter of making sure that they are doing their part to expedite their permitting process so that applicants can come before our tax credit and bond committee, so that they can actually apply. And I know Gustavo has an exciting new program he's gonna be rolling out next year, which is gonna even expedite some of the larger affordable housing projects in these major cities. And I'm just gonna turn it over to him, perhaps for some introductory remarks, and then we can get into the nitty gritty of what we're actually doing, if that's okay with you, Senator.
That's fantastic. Director Velasquez, you're on. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you, Treasurer. It's great to see you. It's always great to see you. Senator Dodd, thank you very much for having me and the Treasurer here at your first town hall of the new year. It really is a pleasure to be with you and your constituents. In your opening remarks, Senator, you were hitting the nail on the head and laying out the huge housing challenges that we face here in the state. No district, no town, no city is immune from a crisis of housing affordability. As much as we all wish there was a silver bullet to solve all of our problems, there really isn't. It's only made worse by the circumstances we find ourselves today. Events like, of course, COVID, the state's drought, the tragic wildfires. I mean, there was already a crisis of housing affordability before these events that I'm describing, let alone after this event. So the good news here is that we have been provided with a historic opportunity to get really big things done. Opportunities to keep Californians in their homes, prevent and hopefully in due time end homelessness and increase housing production and accessibility. Many of these are opportunities provided through the good works of you, Senator, your colleagues in the Capitol, especially to remove institutional barriers that have held back progress. I'm going to talk a little bit about those institutional barriers in a minute, but I just want to take a point of personal privilege here because, as you know, the governor yesterday unveiled his proposed budget. I know there'll be a lot of debate, discussion with you, Senator, and your colleagues in the weeks and months ahead. But I think what we are seeing from the governor's announcement yesterday is the continued intention to move forward with urgency on four fronts, I would say. Homelessness, housing accountability, streamlining our housing program so that we get units online faster, and certainly the Treasury is a champion in that, making sure that we build more housing more quickly. And fourth, creating housing opportunities that simultaneously help relieve the effects of climate change. And I'll also talk just for a few minutes later about that. But just taking into effect what the governor and legislature have agreed upon last year, you know, with the California Compact Plan, the single largest investment in housing and homelessness in the history of the state, $10 billion in affordable housing programs and another $12 billion to address homelessness. That was last year. What the governor announced yesterday is, he calls it a California blueprint, but really the backdrop is this California Compact Plan, which has unprecedented level of investments in housing and homelessness. At the end of the day, when all of these resources are deployed, we'll have somewhere in the neighborhood of 84,000-85,000 new units of housing, of which 44,000 is likely more than half, will be homes and treatment beds that will come online to help those living on the streets. I'd like to spend just a few minutes to highlight what we're doing, especially on homelessness, since it's such a big topic, right? Every issue that every town, every city is not immune. And you should be proud that California has one model that it really is resonating throughout the country. It's called Home Key. You probably have seen this program in the news. It funds local governments to buy existing hotels, motels, but other types of structures as well, and convert them into permanent supportive housing for those experiencing homelessness. The state invested $800 million last year, thanks to funding from both the state and the federal government. Thank you, Senator Dodd. And now we are by basically tripling, because of the success of this program, we're tripling the investment in Home Key. When this program gets fully implemented in about a year and a half from now, there will be 16 new units of housing created for those that are experiencing homelessness. We have other programs. Treasurer knows very well that we've been, you know, trying to get money out under this new initiative called the California Housing Accelerator, another $2 billion, so that projects that have been waiting, tax credit, but they haven't complete full financing to actually start construction, that they actually get to the finish line, very quickly. And an important vehicle for keeping people housed, it's not just about production, creating new units, but it's, again, keeping people stably housed, right? The effects of COVID has made this a priority to make sure that people don't get evicted, because if they do, given the fact that they lost income, wages, they couldn't pay rent and utilities, then where are they going to go, given the tremendous shortage in housing that we face in the state? Well, we have a program, Housing is Key, a rental assistance program, largest rental relief program in the country that so far has helped 150,000 households avoid eviction. Happy, maybe if there are some questions about how is this program working in Sonoma and Napa, in places like Davis and Woodland, I'd be happy to. I have specific numbers of how this program is hitting the ground on people that have been unable to pay rent and utilities during the pandemic. And, you know, I know I'm, you know, I love data. I like to throw out a lot of numbers, but behind the numbers, you know, thousands of real individuals and families that are being served will give them security and stability and improve the chances for prosperity. And so, and we, you know, this rental relief program is so important. We just got word just a few weeks ago that the federal government believes California is doing really well, is transferring an additional $62 million to keep the program going. And we will not stop until we get more money so that we continue to accept applications and provide more relief. But we have, you know, in addition to just this big picture, we have also strategies for specific populations, specific areas. We have a comprehensive, for example, farm working strategy for housing. Essential workers who gave so much during the pandemic to keep us fed, you know, we do need to take care of that population. Wildfires, you know, we're deep into rebuilding communities devastated by 2018, 2017. Wildfires, Treasurer has done a tremendous work with the disaster recovery tax credits, and we're complementing that with other subsidies provided by the federal government. But this is money, right? This is half of the orange. It's a really important part of it. I mean, money, housing requires a lot of money to be built and to be maintained, to make it sustainable over a long period of time, especially for the homeless and for those that are in extreme poverty. But the other side of the equation is local planning and accountability. The other half is making sure local governments are doing what they need to plan for and implement land use policies and programs that will pave the way for creating the housing that we need. We've been waiting far too long. The state can do a lot. You know this, Senator Dodd, but at the end of the day, the housing projects are going to be approved at the local level. And if they don't want to, if communities don't want to approve, then that's where it'll stop. So it's very, very important, this other part of the equation. And thanks to you, Senator, your support, others in the legislature, the governor recently announced the establishment of a housing accountability and enforcement unit at HCD that is going to be looking at how cities, counties are planning for housing for the future. A few weeks after that, you notice the Attorney General also proposed his own housing strike force to add more attorneys to work together with HCD to make sure that we have the housing at the local level. We have approval at the of housing at the local level that are so, so important. So let me just finish here my remarks, and, you know, happy to bring it back to you, Treasurer, whatever Senator you want to do next, but happy to answer questions. But let me promote three sort of quick things as we go into the heavy 2022 cycle of our housing and homelessness programs. First, in 2022, you will see that we have launched a program called the Pro Housing Designation Program. This is a program that local jurisdictions can apply to. It's really about local giving incentives to local jurisdictions for more money, more state subsidy, if they continue to work within their local communities to create the policy landscape, the local policy landscape that facilitates more creation, more openness to creation of more housing at the local level. That's number one. Number two, climate and housing. We believe, just the same way that we said that housing is health, we knew that if people were stably housed, they could be protected from COVID. Same thing we can say about housing can positively affect our climate goals as well. Where we build infill parcels, areas in our state that reduce dependence on cars, all of that is going to be very important. Places away from wildfire zones, all of that is going to be very, very important in the months and years ahead in terms of how we plan for housing. And the third aspect that I want to mention is we're going to be putting out in the next few weeks a statewide housing plan that will sort of lay out what are going to be our major initiatives, looking at more production of housing in the right places, encouraging diverse types of housing. It will lay aim on keeping Californians in their homes, preventing evictions, ensuring that our existing stock doesn't roll off into market rate properties, preservation, something that also you, Treasury, care deeply about, reaffirms addressing homelessness through HomeKey and other programs. And look, one thing is certain, right? We will continue to deliver on the housing promise that the governor has made to Californians. We're proud to be your partner, Senator Dodd and Treasurer. We look forward to working with both of you in 2022. It's really a privilege and an honor to implement the will of the governor and legislature in the area of housing. And we have to continue to act with urgency because this is one of the most important challenges that we face in California. And without addressing it, the prosperity of millions of Californians is at stake. Without housing, people will greatly suffer. So we need to keep working on this agenda very strongly this year.
Thank you, Director Velasquez. Appreciate you being here again. Rick, I think we're to you now. Let's see what kind of questions we have for our guests, or all three of us, actually.
I think we might throw it back to the treasurer because Director Velasquez asked her a few things that she probably needs to respond to.
Yeah, so that would be great. Thank you. So a couple things I forgot to mention. Number one, this is the first year that the Treasurer's Office issued bonds to the Santa Rosa Community College. First time that we are getting into the student housing space, and we hope to work with other community college sites to provide this needed housing because so many community college students are either couch surfing or living in their cars. They also are experiencing homelessness, and so we are very excited to embark on this first bond sale, which would provide 352 new student housing beds on the Santa Rosa Community College site. So that is really exciting for us. Home ownership, you talked about home ownership, Senator Dodd. And I have found as I travel around the state that the places that have been permitted for single family residential homes don't have the money for infrastructure. Whereas before, local governments used to provide the infrastructure, the roads and the undergrounding and the water and the ground wastewater recycling plants. Now they are saying it's up to the developers to come up with that money. And it's very hard to pencil some of these projects in the Inland Empire, San Bernardino, Coachella Valley, Imperial County, if the developers have to pay for all the infrastructure, that increases the cost that is passed on to homeowners. And so there are thousands of permitted sites ready to go, but for infrastructure. And we're hoping that the federal government with their bill that was passed is going to provide some of that assistance so that we can get more homes built. I'm also a voting member on the California Earthquake Authority. So we have been providing grants to homeowners who retrofit their homes through the Brace and Bolt program. We are also hoping, fingers crossed, for a lot more assistance from the federal government so that we can potentially retrofit another 21,000 homes. So that should be coming in 2022, and I will work with you to get that out to your constituents who want to make sure in the next earthquake that their homes are properly retrofitted. And then another program that I'm excited about, and perhaps Gustavo can talk about, the ADU program. I did not really know that the ADU and the junior ADU program actually passed the legislature and the governor, and therefore people with homes can build if it's allowed by their local jurisdiction and they have enough room. But this is really going to keep seniors in their homes. Those folks who have been in their homes, their Social Security is not keeping up with their expenses, and therefore being able to create an ADU, rent it out for some extra rental income is something that really excites me. And maybe Gustavo can talk about it, because some of the jurisdictions don't know about it or they don't want to permit it, but is law.
I think we're going to take our first caller, and I think he's hitting on something that seems to be a big issue, and that is basically all housing is local. And if a community is such as Karen or Kimberly Russo in Davis said, my town of Davis rejected a beautiful neighborhood plan in favor of a field just the other year, that the full jurisdiction over what housing happens is local. And Rick is also talking about, from Roanoke Park, wants to know about red tape in housing. Rick, you're on.
Oh, thank you very much. Well, here in Sonoma County, after
hello, Rick.
Can you hear me?
Line one, Rick, you're on.
Can you hear me?
No. Okay. Then we have Terry and Boys, Sonoma Boys, about preventing sprawl, particularly in the Sonoma Developmental Center. Terry, you're on. And maybe we have technical difficulties. Okay, we're going to go with Rick. We're going to go with Rick from Roanoke Park again. Hello, Rick.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, great. Well, here in Sonoma County, after the fires of 2017, there was, of course, a great rush to try to build a lot more homes to replace those that were burned down. And people were talking a lot about cutting through red tape. Well, here's the thing about red tape. What looks like red tape to one person is essential environmental and health and safety regulations to others. And I think there's a conflict here, and we have to be careful as we try to deal with the current crisis in housing, that we don't sacrifice some of the gains that we've made over the years in environmental protections quality of building and so on. So I just wondered if anybody wants to comment on that. Thank you.
I'll start out having been, you know, representing, of course, Sonoma and Napa that went through the, you know, the 17 and 18 and 19, frankly, fires. And, you know, one of the things for local elected officials and as former county supervisor in Napa County, the idea that you're going to make somebody that lost everything in their home, and they've had a home there for 20 or 30 years, and now you're all of a sudden going to be putting obstacles in front of them to rebuild their home, doesn't really sit well, you know, frankly. But I do think your point's well taken as we look to new opportunities for new homes. And I really do believe that the local agencies have has a responsibility to make sure that the environmental standards that we have in the state are adhered to. And I don't believe that what we're trying to do here flies in the face of the state's fantastic environmental record over the years.
Okay, I'm sorry. People are typing things to me. Does anybody else have a comment on that subject?
Well, there were a few comments before Rick, the person that addressed the local approvals, commented on Davis, and then I loved the opportunity to talk about ADUs. The treasurer asked me to address. Can I just speak briefly about those two matters?
Sure.
Okay. There's a reason why the recently submitted both Woodland and Davis housing elements have at this moment been rejected by the State Department. Look, let me explain something. We are entering, this is kind of wonky, but we are entering what it's called the sixth cycle of our regional housing needs assessment. So every roughly 8 years, regions have to plan for new housing. And then they come up with a big number for the region, and then they have to put from that number specific numbers to each locality within that region. So we just went through that exercise for the next 8 or 9 years. The reality is that when you look at what happened in the fifth cycle, the cycle before the new cycle, housing was built in a very, very limited basis. Just to give you a sense, across the state, only four units of housing out of 10 were created for people that were moderate income families, your law enforcement officers, your nurses, your teachers. Only about 4 out of 10 units that should have been created in the state in the last 8 or 9 years were created. But when you go to the people that are extremely low income, your service hospitality workers, your janitor, your cooks in these kitchens, only 1 out of 10 units of housing that should have been created were created. We can no longer for the upcoming cycle believe that we need to continue on that pattern. We can no longer accept, and I'm going to use a terrible word here, kind of the mediocrity of local jurisdictions submitting housing that is not going to create housing elements that are not going to create the type of housing that we need in the state. So right now we are engaged with Woodland, with Davis, so that they go back to the drawing board and they rethink, where can we build more housing in these communities? Now, the advantage of Solano, Napa is that they come into in 2023, so we don't have to review housing elements. But it's very, very important that these local communities are engaged with their local officials and their planning officials so that more work is done to open up the space, to open up the opportunities for more housing in these communities. Now, ADUs is a perfect example, just very briefly, of the type of housing that is kind of exploding in the state. 300% increase in accessory dwelling units. Some people call it the granny flats, or the small units that you build in your same lot. Of course, SB9 that the Senator Dodd talked about is kind of gonna be a game changer in that front, but because it has the potential to split lots. But right now what we have is accessory dwelling units, and we have to make sure the local jurisdictions understand that there is a state law that requires permitting of these accessory dwelling units automatically. And if that doesn't happen, then they would be in violation of the state law. So what we're trying to say here is there's an opportunity to create more housing on many fronts. And we just have to make sure that local jurisdictions embrace, celebrate the opportunity that the state and the state legislatures are giving these local communities to plan for more housing, because this is a huge need in these local jurisdictions.
Speaking of a very sensitive local housing issue in Sonoma, Terry is on line 3 with regards to the Sonoma Developmental Center. Terry?
Yes, hello. Good evening, Senator Dodd, Treasurer Ma, and Director Gustavo. Thank you very much. And the comments about the RENA numbers are very pertinent to my question. We do understand that climate smart housing is for info makes a lot of sense, but how can the state of California support sprawl into the rural and agricultural lands in unincorporated Sonoma County and other places like Santa Clara, which will increase greenhouse gas emissions. And locally, we're talking about the Sonoma Developmental Center, where the county is planning a large volume of housing, which is far from any urban growth boundaries. It's out in a rural community that is has no transit or services. So how will the state of California ensure that you're not supporting sprawl?
Well, I can maybe take a stab at that. In terms of our regulation and application guidelines, we do give extra points if you are by a real transit hub. For example, this year we're giving points for environmental benefits to help with climate change. And so how we score these applicants really does play a role in where these projects are located. So in terms of the Sonoma Developmental Center, because there is no, you know, transit, there's no amenities close by like schools and grocery stores and hospitals, and other you know, amenities, they're not going to score that well when they apply for either tax credits and or bonds. So that's kind of how we are trying to address it, to really promote transit-oriented development. For example, right, BART has been expanding, and we want to build more housing around transit so people don't have to have a car and they can ride public transportation. Like, we are thinking about that, and that's how we set up our scoring system.
And I think that specifically she was pretty much talking about the proposal. You know, first of all, I just want to give you an outline of really what happened with this. Senator McGuire and I really wanted to make sure that as the Sonoma Developmental Center closed their doors after so many years in operation there, that we wanted to make sure that the local community, you know, continue to have the open space and everything in the hills and you know, in that area. The state of California normally on these things will move property like that to the highest bidder. And we, Senator McGuire and I, were able to get them to concede and work with us and say, hey, we really don't want that. We want a process for our local communities to be able to, you know, to weigh in. It has been fast because of COVID. You know, I don't want, you know, I'm not going to throw anybody under the bus, but the reality is we are where we are. We have tight timelines. The state of California spent probably, I mean, a lot more money on this warm closure than they ever anticipated. We're going to hang in there, but the county of Sonoma knows the rules of engagement. They were clearly negotiated early on, and I really believe that if the residents in the area work together with the county, that it doesn't have to tie into, you know, one scenario or another. There's always opportunity to change things. But one final point, or a couple final points. One is probably there's not going to be a lot more activity there than there was at the heyday of the Sonoma Developmental Center when it was up and operating. And I think that's the baseline, you know, that people were looking at. And I think I'll just leave it at that for now. That's a thumbnail sketch of really what's happened.
Yeah, we got to get back to the phone. Scott has been holding. Scott in Sonoma, he wants to ask about alternative building options and the current general economy related to home prices. Scott.
Hi, thanks for taking my call. I think Director Velasquez addressed a little bit of this, but I'm going to hit a few points real quickly. I'm a member of HAS Sonoma, which is in the process of applying for home key funds to develop a 40-plus bed emergency and transitional housing center based on the work of Homeward Bound in Marin County. We're building that. We purchased property and have a demonstration of our temporary models up for why we'll be building a permanent facility. It's on Highway 12, right next to Agua Caliente Creek. I'm also part of the Housing Advisory Committee for the general plan update, so I'd like to hear what the senator has or anybody has on any of these issues. One is Vancouver has used or started an empty buildings tax. So 1% of assessed value, if that building is not occupied, goes to a fund which will be used to build more housing. The second idea I would like to ask what you think about or how we can do this is to rezone shopping centers, because this is underdeveloped land that we can increase the density and create vibrant 24-hour high-density neighborhoods. The final point is more to the general economic climate and what I would call economic climate change. Sort of throw a quick statistic out. In 1940, average home price and average income were equal. The American dream was easily achievable by the average American. And we know today that that has changed drastically to where average home price is 20 times average income. So we have 1/20th the buying power of the greatest generation. I don't see how we can address this issue without addressing that larger issue or finding ways to mitigate the way the climate has changed. And I'd like to hear what anybody or everybody has to say on these. Thank you.
Yeah, I would just like to add that we are working on the Treasurer's Office on a white paper or study to present to the legislature and the governor on an initiative we would like to see on the November 2022 ballot that would essentially create a first-time home buyer down payment assistance that would be funded through the state. And this would give a lot of opportunities for those folks who haven't been able to get that down payment assistance easily through their financial institutions, especially after the 2008 Great Recession. So this may be a game changer as well for people who want to afford a home but can't afford it because they're not able to save for that down payment assistance. So stay tuned to see if we can get it through the legislature and on the ballot for November.
I think the caller had a couple of really great points. And the one on the empty building tax, that's not new. I know that in my district, the city of Napa has considered that. A lot of, once again, a lot of politics involved in that. I'm not aware, Director, are you aware of any communities that have that already?
No, I know Southern California, has been in LA County, there's been two small jurisdictions that have been proposing that for a while, but I don't know if that actually has come through. But what I can tell you is the governor's budget yesterday included $100 million for a new adaptive reuse program. We are going to start working on those guidelines because it's very, very important to look at these commercial facilities, some, empty facilities where we can create some interesting models of adaptive reuse and convert them into housing. So I know there's been in the state legislature efforts to move in that direction, aside from the tax issue. But we're going to be putting some guidelines about how this adaptive reuse program would work. And we welcome the feedback from communities, because I know it's something that some local communities are thinking about it.
Yeah, and I just want to say, going back to adaptive reuse, these projects already have undergrounding. They have parking and pavement and cable access. And so these are actually the projects that would be a natural to create more housing versus an empty lot or a field that has nothing on it.
Real quick on that same subject, Nancy Maul had written in, Senator Dodd, where do you stand on AB 672? The bill is trying to convert publicly owned golf courses into affordable housing. She thinks all open spaces should be considered and not just public golf courses.
Well, I think that, I don't have the bill in front of me. I don't have all the facts of the bill and everything. But in general, basically what that does is that I think paves the way for the local communities to be able to make those type of decisions themselves. I don't know that that bill is a by right thing where they can just, because of the state I don't think that's what a bill would say, but I could be wrong. I have not reviewed that bill. It's in the assembly, but I'll certainly be paying attention to that. Gustavo, do you know anything about that?
I do, only because we have to create those complex fiscal impact statements for every bill. And but I actually don't know all the specifics there. I'm gonna have to, you know, dig in deeper. I just don't know all the facts. So.
Okay, we'll take it up another time. Efren wants to have a few comments or questions about housing. Efren?
Yes, good evening. Can you hear me okay?
Yep.
Good evening, Efren Carrillo with Burbank Housing. Senator Dodd, thank you so much for hosting this critical town hall. Treasurer Ma and Director Velasquez, it's good to see you both as well. Larry sends his regards. He couldn't make it this evening. But I first want to make a comment and really thank Treasurer Ma for her work on getting the disaster credits dispersed. I think all told, there's just a short of 10 projects that were funded through those disaster tax credits in Senator Dodd's district, both in Sonoma and Napa counties. Director Velasquez, wanted to thank you for your work on the Community Development Block Grant Disaster Recovery Funds and being able to disperse those out. You know, recognizing that these were one-time funds, there is, in fact, still a lot of recovery work to be done. And we are asking that there be consideration of the possibility of an incentive or a point or some type of a preference for recovery projects that come after state funding. We understand that California Coalition of Rural Housing may be making a similar ask on that front as well. Director Velasquez, I was heartened to hear your comments around the accelerator funds and really focusing on the backlog that we have across the state on projects that are developments that have been entitled, approved by local jurisdictions, and are just essentially necessitating the necessary funding. And we, you know, us in the affordable housing world are curious as to what the status of that may be, and whether there may be additional action given the inaction happening in Washington, D.C., whether there will be additional support in supplementing some of that backlog. A couple other items that I hope that you may address. You know, we are concerned about the emphasis on high resource areas and the focus around 100% homeless housing, which in effect has put some of the Bay Area at a significant disadvantage in the recent rounds, be it the TCAC, SIDLAC, or HCD programs. The upcoming SuperNOFA, we think, has great intentions, but we do think that it may miss its goal of fully funding projects, specifically around deep affordability and the threshold item for programs such as the Joe Serna Farm Worker Program or the Veterans Housing Program to better serve the population. And then just lastly, and I apologize for taking this long, but there's just so much that you both have covered and important work for both of our counties here, but the viability of projects in the queue for Home Key, we've been excited about that opportunity, both in Napa County, in partnership with the city and county, and in Sonoma County, and we wonder if there would be an opportunity or willingness to move some of the funding into round Home Key 2 rather than holding it up for round 3. Thank you so much for the time.
Well, there was a lot there. There's certainly a lot there, but I know.
And let me just, fair warning, we only have a couple more minutes left. So.
Well, very quickly, because let's engage on the home key. We, you know, there are three stages, and we kind of have to wait to see how stage one develops to move to the next one. But I'm happy to keep this conversation about how we can make that work on home, on 100% homeless housing. Yeah, actually, we have actually proposed changes. The treasurer knows this to scale back to more like half homeless. Because integration is important, right? We want to make sure that we have integrated patterns in the housing that the state is subsidizing. So we actually are making a correction there, same way that we're making a correction on hire resources. We're making sure that we have a balanced approach, hire resources, but also in other communities that have been disinvested and that people want to stay in place, and they, if they, that's where they wish to live, well, the opportunity should be there. Disaster recovery, yes, we're moving very quickly, I should say. The federal government has just announced more than $300 million for the 2020 wildfires, so we'll be putting out information on how that money will be distributed in addition to all the work being done for 2017 and 2018 fires. And that's what I remember from the question.
Okay, so I will just add, thank you, Ephraim and Burbank Housing. You are the reason that we got the federal tax credits to begin with. Thanks to your advocacy with Congressman Mike Thompson, and it's continued. And I missed that, Gustavo, so I need to get more details about this upcoming round of disaster credits. And so we will again be busy. But for the first time, I convened a 30-person working stakeholder group where usually government makes decisions with government people. I decided to say, I want to hear from the stakeholders. They understand their inventory, their funding needs, their communities, where they have property, what is able to be developed shovel ready right now. And we, the committee, has really looked to this working group to give us guidance on our regulation changes, how we set our competition up, the needs in different communities, disaster credits, for example. You know, Sonoma and Napa were very, very active in helping us develop the funding competition so that, you know, we could rebuild in locations that were actually in the fire perimeter. And that's something that we heard from the community, that if we're gonna rebuild, it's not right to let other people who are not rebuilding in the fire devastated areas to get the priority for bonds and tax credits versus, you know, focused on those people that have lost everything in these fires. And so we really thank the community for actively being engaged. If you join our meetings, you know that I don't have a limit on public comment. Sometimes our meetings go 5-6 hours or more because we really want to hear from the public, and we take all of your comments into consideration. So we encourage you to join us at our CIDLAC TCAC meetings. Moving forward, all the agendas are online. Our next funding meeting is next week, but every year we reevaluate, like Director Velasquez says, and we tweak and we change and we prioritize different types of projects. So to the extent that you have more projects in these fire devastated areas, let us know. We need to know what your inventory is so that we can adjust the allocation method for, you know, this year is a little late because we've been doing it for the last 4 months, but every, you know, fall to December, we do change the rules and allocations.
We have one last question on the line from Adam in Fairfield, and the producer told me we wanted to take this question about solar required on new housing. Adam?
Thank you all very much for taking my question. I'll try to make this brief because I know we have a little bit of time. So the California Public Utilities Commission, they have a new net energy metering policy 3.0 that they're making a vote on. And the effect of it is that it has a new net grid benefit charge, which drastically increases the prices for both for anybody who's got solar, you know, to the point where it makes it very hard to break even. The second development is that there's a self-generation incentive power program that PG&E runs, and that's for those of us that have batteries. And again, you all know that solar power only works during the day, and so you need batteries in order to reduce the load. And those incentives have now been, PG&E has been stalling them and then not giving them. And so I guess my question is how can we try to, you know, encourage the use of green energy and green power in California when these incentive programs are going to penalize folks who are trying to do the right thing, and all new housing that's going to be tried to be built with green energy?
Well, let's get some quick answers to that.
Well, let me start. You know, I've had a number of my constituents calling and railing on this specific issue. I found not one of those constituents had ever read the PUC briefing on it, candidly. And so I would ask you, if you don't have it, contact my office We can get it to you. You can go online to the PUC. You know, the reality is the solar industry, they have to do what they have to do. That's a fact of life. They're protecting all their members and, frankly, their customers. But from what I've seen on their flyer that went out, I didn't really believe it was terribly accurate in complete and forthcoming. So I ask you to look at that. And, you know, also, you can certainly comment to the CPUC and get your, you know, get your voice heard. One of the things is that I just do have to mention, we have to find a way to have some balance, because right now we're probably paying 14 times more for solar generated off a rooftop than we are from in excess charges than we are for other sources. So when they first put out this program, there wasn't really cheap, affordable solar yet. And now we've got it, we've got it plentiful. And the idea is, it seems to me, that what they're trying to do is say, hey, maybe what we can do is grants, something like that, to be able to help put in batteries so that you're using your excess power to power your home at night, where it really makes sense, where we so you're not using greenhouse gas type of energy that's generated, because the renewables are very, very, very hard to come by 24 hour.
KSVY Sonoma.
Well, that's kind of the hard stop for us. Thank you all very much for being here. My privilege to be a part of this. Thanks to all the callers and the all the people who sent in questions. Sorry we didn't get to all of your questions, but I think many of them were covered in the general comments and the follow-up questions. So, and Senator Dodd's office is always available to answer any other questions that you have. So, Senator, I'll let you have the final word.
Well, thank you very much again, Rick. Appreciate KSDY and them always stepping up and making this work. And I do want to thank Treasurer Ma. Thank you, as always, for your time. And you're here all the time working with us to try to get stuff done in the state of California. It's amazing. And Gustavo Velasquez, you're our director of HCD. I want to thank you. You are the most hands-on HCD director that I've ever met. And that includes all my years as a county supervisor, where we were fighting HCD all the time. And I really appreciate your straightforwardness, you showing up, and your direct approach to trying to make this state better for all of us in terms of housing affordability and accessibility. So with that, I thank all the viewers tonight for tuning in. I think it's been a great conversation. We'll see you on the next one.
Guinness and local brews on tap. Murphy's has live music Thursday through Monday, trivia every Wednesday evening, and sports on multiple HD TVs indoors and outdoors. For more information, you can visit sonomapub.com.
Roll it.